Hello everyone, and welcome back to another ASMR True Crime Story Time. Tonight I have two cases for you, and they are both out of Australia. The first case is the solved murders of mother and daughter Carly Pierce Stevenson and Candelace Pierce in Australia 2010. The skeletal remains of Carly were found in Bolango State Forest in New South Wales, Australia in 2010. While her daughter Candelace's remains were found in Wynaga, South Australia, which is 680 miles from Bolango, in July 2015. The two cases were not linked until positive identification was confirmed by DNA testing in October 2005. The mother and daughter were last seen by family in 2008 in Alice Springs, the Northern Territory, and reported missing in 2009. However, the report was withdrawn. It had been discovered that Carly's mobile phone was used for years following her death to send false proof of life messages to both her family and her friends. The mother and child's identities were exploited by third parties to commit social security and other types of identity fraud. But who were Carly and Candelace? Well, Carly Jade Pierce Stevenson was born in 1988 in Alice Springs and attended the Breitling Primary School and Alice Springs High School. She was a keen netballer. Her mother died in 2012. But Carly's stepfather and stepbrother still live in Alice Springs to this day. Carly gave birth to her daughter Candelace in 2006. Carly is then believed to have left Alice Springs when Candelace was 2 years old in 2008 in search for work. Police believe that they travelled to Darwin, Adelaide, the Murray and Riverland districts, Victoria and Canberra. A missing person report, like I told you, was raised with the Northern Territory Police by Carly's mother on the 4th of September 2009 and was closed on the 9th of October 2009 after Carly's mother was reassured that Carly was safe and well. However, she did not want any family contact at that time. On the 29th of August 2010, trail bike riders discovered skeletal human remains in the Bolango State Forest in New South Wales. Media reports at first linked the killing to serial killer Ivan Milat and the backpacker murders. In case you don't know who Ivan Milat is and what the backpacker murders are, I'm going to tell you. The backpacker murders were a spate of serial killings that took place in New South Wales, Australia, between 1989 and 1993, and those were committed by Ivan Milat. The bodies of seven missing young people, aged between 19 and 22, were discovered partially buried in the Bolango State Forest, 9.3 miles southwest of the New South Wales town of Berrima. Five of the victims were foreign backpackers, three were German, two were British, and the other two were Australian travellers from Melbourne. Ivan was convicted of the murders on the 27th of July 1996 and was sentenced to seven consecutive life sentences as well as 18 years without parole. He died in prison on the 27th of October 2019, never having confessed to the murders of which he was convicted. But in the case of Carly and Candelace, later forensic examination found the remains had been left there many years after Ivan was sent to prison in 1996. In a 2010 appeal for information, police called Carly the woman angel after the motif on a t-shirt she was wearing. On the 21st of October 2015, the bones found were identified as the body of Carly, aged 20, from Alice Springs. But where was her daughter? On the 15th of July 2015, the remains of a young child, surrounded by girls' clothing, were discovered by passing motorists who examined an abandoned suitcase at the site of the for several years before the remains had been dumped inside the suitcase. And it was not until October 2015 that the victim was identified as Candelace, age 2, who with her mother had been reported missing 5 years earlier in 2009. Soon after the discovery of the child's remains, police made a public appeal for information that could help identify her. Based on items that were found with the suitcase, including children's clothing and a distinctive handmade quilt, more than 1,200 calls came through to Crime Stoppers, and one caller was able to identify the quilt as one made by the child's grandmother, Carly's mother, who had died, believing her granddaughter and daughter were living interstate at the time before she died. Positive identification was achieved by comparing DNA extracted from the child's skeletal remains with DNA retained from a neonatal heel prick test. A national DNA search then linked the child's remains with the profile of her mother. The last confirmed sightings of the mother and daughter were before their deaths were on the 8th of November 2008, when they were stopped by police on the Stuart Highway near Cooper Bedi in the north, far north of South Australia, and in Charnwood, a suburb of Canberra, in October 2008. New South Wales and South Australian police conducted a joint investigation, including collaboration with the ACT and NT police. Strangely, it was established that Carly's mobile phone had been used until mid-2011. She had been communicating via text message, as I told you, to her friends and family, giving the impression she was alive and well. And she also had appealed for money. Her bank account was accessed until at least 2012 at locations in four states and territories. Over $90,000 was stolen through the account, including Centrelink, family payments and other proceeds of fraud. A woman in a wheelchair, accompanied by a man, impersonated Carly to staff at a credit union in June 2010 using Carly's identity documents. And then another woman impersonated her at Centrelink office in South Australia that same year using identity documents for both Carly and her daughter. The woman had had her leg amputated as a result of a car rollover in 2008, in which a man named Daniel was driving on the Stuart Highway north of Maria. Two of her children had been killed in the crash. Within days of releasing the identities of the victims, police reported they did have several suspects, including one in a New South Wales jail awaiting sentencing on unrelated charges. Their main suspect, however, in the case was a man called Daniel James Holden. And on the 28th of October 2015, 41-year-old Daniel James Holden was arrested in Cessnock, New South Wales. He was later charged with the murder of Carly. He was found to be in a relationship with a woman named Hazel Passmore. Hazel is the woman who allegedly stole Carly's identity after she was killed, and investigators believe that they had also been in a relationship at the time of Carly's death. Police allegedly then traced a signal from the man's mobile phone to the location Carly's remains were found at the time of her death in December. In September 2008, the car crash that I told you about had happened, and two of Hazel's children had been killed. Earlier in August 2008, Hazel had also uploaded images of Candelace to her Facebook. Candelace was photographed in the company of Hazel's children at a motor show in Alice Springs. On the 15th of December 2015, Daniel was arrested again in Cessnock for the murder of Candelace. Described as a very violent death, investigators allege Candelace was murdered only a few days of her mother. An officer involved in the investigation remarked it was fortunate the suspect was already in custody, as it allowed police time to conduct a thorough and comprehensive investigation. Daniel was charged at Parramatta local court and he was refused bail. His case was adjourned until the 28th of January 2016, when his trial was intended to take place at the Central Law Courts of Sydney. The case, however, was further adjourned to March, as the police and prosecutors were still collating the brief of evidence, and only one third of it had been provided to the defence lawyers. The case was adjourned again in September 2016 to at least November due to evidence being collected in a total of five jurisdictions. During his committal hearing in August 2017, it was alleged that Daniel had told a witness how he stepped on Carly's throat, crushed her windpipe, then buried her body in the forest. It was also alleged he stopped at a supermarket and bought duct tape and garbage bags before he suffocated Carly in a motel in Narradeera, stuffing her body in a suitcase, and he dumped it in Mynarkey, where it remained for nearly 7 years. His first appearance in the Supreme Court of New South Wales was on the 1st of December 2017. His trial was expected to take 3 months from the 6th of August 2018. However, on the 31st of July 2018, Daniel pleaded guilty to the murders. His sentencing, which was originally set for September the 29th, was then moved to the 9th of November, where he faced 2 life sentences. The brutality of the murders was publicly revealed following his guilty plea. Daniel also had a prior history of violence against women and an interest in sexual violence towards children. A police fact sheet tendered to the court cited evidence of a sexual motive to the murder of the child. Bruce Pierce, Carly's father, and Candelace's grandfather gave a written statement during the sentencing expressing his desire for a death sentence against Daniel. However, New South Wales had abolished the death penalty for murder in 1955. Prosecutor Mark Tedeschi described the murders as a thrill killing and said, quote, "Both murders fall within the worst case and can aptly be described as atrocious, detestable, hateful, gravely reprehensible, and extremely wicked," end quote. On the 30th of November 2018, Daniel was sentenced in the New South Wales Supreme Court to 2 consecutive life sentences without parole for the murders of Carly and Candelace. That was the story of Carly and Candelace. Now, the second case I have for you is the unsolved murder of an 87-year-old Frank Newbury. On the 12th of March 2007, Frank Newbury was found beaten to death inside his convenience store. Frank was a World War II veteran who operated Frank's Hammond Beef at 27 Union Street, Cooks Hill. He was elected as the best grocer in the world by the Cooks Hill community in 2001 for his 50 years of service. Frank's Hammond Beef store had been open daily for 57 years prior to Frank's death. On the 12th of March 2007, at 7 a.m. on the dot, Frank walked downstairs from his flat and opened the door to his convenience store and swung the sign on the window and settled behind the counter. This was the same morning routine he had followed every day since the shop opened in 1949. That's 58 years the shop had been running. It is said that for 58 years, Frank had built a reputation as the gentleman grocer. In the Newcastle neighbourhood of Cooks Hill, remembering regulars' names and orders, offering home delivery services to elderly residents, and genuinely being a constant presence in his community. was unable to give further details, not unusual given the regular air of the afternoon. 6 minutes later, one of Frank's regulars came to the store to find the front glass door shut. Thinking this was unusual, he peered through the tinted windows and he saw a man with long hair wearing either a beanie or a cap, crouching down near the counter. The man was placing something into a green enviro bag. This was undoubtedly the same man that the previous customer had seen, but there was no sign of Frank. The shopkeeper was found roughly 10 minutes later, slumped near the counter of his shop. He had been brutally beaten around the head and was barely alive. He was covered in bruises and lying in a pool of his own blood. Frank was rushed to hospital, but he died that evening as stunned locals crowded the front of his store. When news of his passing spread, the gathering turned into a vigil with dozens trended stories about the gentleman grocer well into the night. Despite a $100,000 reward, no evidence has turned up strong enough to force a conviction. There are no suspects known by name. 8 possible witnesses captured by a security camera attached to the nearby Newcastle Workers Club provided no information, and police are confident they spoke to every one of Frank's customers that day, aside from the aforementioned man spotted in the store around the time of the murder. A Port Stevens man was reportedly boasting about the murder, but was found to be lying. A schizophrenic drug addict who had broken out of a nearby psychiatric hospital twice that same day was a leading suspect, but he was also cleared. Despite his driver's license being found inside Frank's store, Strike Force Renan set up to investigate the case, but encountered dead ends for years. Even the motive for the murder seems unclear. The official cause of Frank's death was blunt force trauma, seemingly from 2 separate weapons. This may suggest 2 attackers or improvisation. The old-fashioned cash register was opened, however, it is unclear if any money had been removed. Police initially operated on the theory of a robbery gone wrong, but Frank had $1,500 in cash in his pocket at the time of the death. If this was a robbery, it was a brazen and badly conducted one, giving the remaining cash on his person. How busy the store was usually, and that the murder was conducted in broad daylight. Police were clinging to this theory during the 2012 inquest, telling the coroner they believed it was a bungled robbery. But the coroner wasn't convinced, and he delivered an open finding. By 2015, police had shifted their thinking, admitting that Frank may have been specifically targeted by the murderer. Detective Sergeant Matthew Faber told the Newcastle Herald, quote, "While we believe that robbery gone wrong has always appeared to be the most likely scenario, we will consider and explore all possibilities, including that the incident could have been a deliberate attack upon Mr. Newbury." End quote. As time goes on, the chance of finding Frank's killer has grown slimmer. Strike Force Renan has ordered extensive DNA testing in the past, which uncovered nothing of note. However, this latest review of the case will see New South Wales Police use a previously unavailable genetic genealogy DNA database, similar to the type used by Ancestry Services, as well as DNA for phenotyping, which can develop a facial likeness based on DNA code. There are substantial leaps in technology these days that may yield positive results now the case has been reopened. For now, Frank's Ham and Beef is still open, Monday to Friday, in the same building. It is now owned and ran by a former customer called Jenny Boswell, who describes Frank's murder as a tragedy that people just can't get over in our town. For now, she says she's running the little store by the same principles as Frank, although she does not close at 5, but she closes at 4 p.m. That was Frank's case. Now, I personally believe that Lily's murder any names or places wrong and you are from Australia and you know that, I knew I'd have